This video is sponsored by NordVPN. In the fall of 1959, a very big and very unusual traveler tackled the world's weirdest road trip ever, on an 8,500-kilometer journey of epic proportions. But the traveler wasn't an explorer or even a tourist. The intrepid traveler was a giant block of ice, weighing in at 3,050 kilograms. First, let's take a step back. Though the trip was taken in the fall of 1959, the journey's inspiration came in the previous summer. During that summer, Radio Luxembourg challenged any and all listeners to transport 3 tons of ice from the Arctic Circle all the way to the mega-hot conditions of the Earth's equator. The station set 2 major rules. First, they said that no refrigeration could be used, making the trip a tricky proposition. The second rule was this, that for every kilogram of ice that remained upon arrival at the equator, the challenger would receive 100,000 francs, which equates to around 16,000 current American dollars. If the trip were taken today, the big block of ice would have been worth around a whopping 48 million at the beginning of the trip, so anyone willing to attempt the challenge was dealing with a very pricey piece of ice. Radio Luxembourg, of course, thought that no one would attempt the challenge. Surely it was an impossible task. Surely no one could transport a block of ice all the way from the Arctic to the equator without the ice melting in a journey that would likely take many weeks. Or so they thought. One man stepped up and accepted the challenge. This man was Birger Natvik, the managing director of the Norwegian insulation material company Glasfat. He was confident that his company's glass wool insulation could get the job done. If he could make it happen, he could win a huge amount of money for the company and its employees. In his bid to assemble a team capable of completing the challenge, Natvik received a lot of attention. Radio Luxembourg heard about Natvik's ambitions and quickly retracted their offer. They were terrified by how much money they might lose. But Natvik decided to continue with his quest. Though he could no longer win any money, he and his company could potentially receive a huge amount of publicity. And so the trip was ready to begin. The ice and its entourage were set to travel all the way from the Norwegian town of Mo i Rana to Libreville, the modern-day capital of Gabon. The epic journey was set to take the intrepid explorers through Copenhagen, Hamburg, Brussels, Paris, Algiers, Niger, and more, as the icy block made its way from the world's coldest region to some of the hottest countries on the planet. The team was assembled. Natvik handed the job over to Sivert Klevan, an expert engineer with excellent public relations skills. Joining the team were numerous drivers, a workshop manager, and a 2-person film crew. When the trip started getting massive media attention, many companies came forward to sponsor the journey. In total, sponsors from 8 countries financed the expedition, including Shell, who provided fuel, and Scania, who provided the truck. Procuring the entire 3-ton block of ice from Arctic glaciers in one go seemed like an extremely difficult task. So instead, 200 kilogram blocks were cut out and airlifted to the starting point. They were then frozen together to form a solid block of ice weighing 3,050 kilograms. The ice was placed in a specially constructed iron container and insulated with wood and 10-inch thick glass wool made from glass fiber. The truck was also loaded with 300 kilograms of medicine to be delivered to the Hospital of Humanitarian Albert Schweitzer, near the final destination of Libreville, the capital of Gabon. On February 22, 1959, the trip began. The European stretch of journey was relatively easy, as temperatures were pleasant, roads were good, and conditions were stable. At every big city, crowds would gather, applaud, and watch, as news of the journey spread across the world. And as the journey picked up pace, so too did the publicity. The team and the trip were very quickly becoming famous. When the team reached Paris, the police escorted the ice-carrying truck through the city's busy streets. The crew were even invited to dine with the mayor. Upon reaching Marseille, it was time to leave Europe behind and enter the less hospitable conditions of Africa. For the rest of their journey, the team would largely be traveling through the scorching hot sands of the Sahara Desert. In Marseille's port, the entire truck, with ice still loaded upon it, was lifted onto a boat which carried the cargo over the ocean. The team and their icy load had arrived in Africa. This African stretch was a very dangerous part of the journey. Not only was the ice at risk of melting under the scorching sun, but the truck's crew were also at risk of death. Parts of the mega-hot, vast, sandy Sahara were involved in war, and many sections were full of guerrilla forces hiding in the mountains. These fighters were a huge threat. They might steal the 300 kilograms of medicine which the crew were carrying, or worse, they might capture and kill the crew in a quest for publicity. Because of these dangers, for some parts of the desert section, the crew were accompanied by the French Foreign Legion, who were stationed in the area at the time. The French Foreign Legion instructed the crew to drive for their lives, and to stop as little as possible. What had started as a fun publicity stunt had become a fight for survival. But even though the crew wanted to make fast progress, they were unable to do so. Large stretches of the Sahara had no roads, so the crew simply had to drive through the sand. And because the truck was so heavy, it would regularly become trapped in the sand's depths. Every time this happened, the ice-carrying team would spend hours digging at the sand to free the truck and its precious cargo. In temperatures of 50 degrees Celsius, with few resources and the fatal threat of freedom fighters, it was an insanely dangerous mission. Small sections of the ice were beginning to melt, threatening to make the journey a complete failure. If the crew got stuck in the sand for a prolonged period of time, the ice might not survive. During this stretch of the journey, the crew met a tribe of nomadic Tuareg people who were riding on the backs of camels. The crew offered water to the nomads' camels by opening up the container which was carrying the ice. The lucky camels helped themselves to drinking what was the world's most expensive water, a precious liquid which had already traveled thousands of miles from the Norwegian glacier which had once been its home. As the crew continued through the desert, they often slept in sleeping bags on the sands of the Sahara, somehow managing to gradually navigate the terrain and all of its challenges. And they somehow succeeded, as eventually they left the inhospitable sands behind and crept closer to their final destination of Gabon. Soon, they eventually and miraculously reached their intended destination. 27 days after they departed, the crew and the remaining ice had reached Libreville. They were safe. They had completed their seemingly impossible journey. But how much ice was left? With trepidation, the block was weighed, and the results were nothing short of a miracle. Upon leaving Norway, the block had weighed 3,050 kilograms. Now, 27 days later, right on the line of the sweltering equator, it weighed 2,714 kilograms. Only 336 kilograms of ice had been lost along the way. Only 11% of the ice had disappeared. Though Radio Luxembourg's initial challenge and the financial reward that went with it had been revoked, the journey was a success. If the cash reward had still been in place, the ice would have had a modern-day worth of around $43 million, making it the world's most pricey piece of frozen water. The ice, instead of making a huge profit for the company, was put to an even better use. Though a small amount was flown back home, most of it was cut up and given to the people of Gabon, who had never before seen ice. Upon arriving in Libreville, the crew were invited to attend dinner with the French President Charles de Gaulle in Paris, but only if they would drive back to the French capital. The exhausted crew refused and decided to fly home instead. The ice which was flown back to Norway was cut up and used in drinks, which were then served to journalists at the premiere of the expedition's documentary. The publicity stunt definitely worked, as Glasfot still exists today, under the name Glava AS. 61 years after the awesome expedition, the company is still crafting glass wool for use as insulation. Based in the town of Askim, around 1,000 kilometers from where their incredible expedition first began, they employ upwards of 500 staff. The Ice Block Expedition of 1959 was successful thanks to the protective insulating glass wool that acted as a barrier between the frozen ice and the harsh environment outside. In the era of internet, where more and more people are working from home, you need similar protection to protect your internet data and activities from prying eyes. NordVPN helps you achieve that. NordVPN encrypts all of your data coming in and out of your computer or mobile phone, making it a lot harder for someone to hack you or a malicious service to harm you. It also keeps your physical location and internet history private, preventing your internet provider from selling them to ad companies. Using NordVPN, you can reroute your internet traffic from other countries to minimize government surveillance or enjoy movies and TV shows that aren't available in your country yet. NordVPN works with Netflix and other popular streaming sites. NordVPN only costs $3.49 a month, and if you use the link in the description, nordvpn.com/sidenote, you can get 70% off the 3 years plan and an extra month free. The plan also comes with a 30-day money-back guarantee.